Good morning, everyone. Welcome to day two or two and a half of the Socialism 2008 conference. I want to thank you all for getting here bright and early like this. I know a lot of people were out singing socialist tunes and everything else last night. I heard that was a lot of fun. My name's Lucy. I'm from New York City. I'm also a member of 1199 SEIU. And I'm going to be chairing this meeting this morning. We have a very exciting meeting this morning with none other than Dave Zirin. And Dave is, I'd say probably, one of the funniest nationally syndicated sports writers on the revolutionary left, at least one of the top five or so, Dave is a radical sports writer, editor, and columnist for thenation.com. He's a columnist for sportsillustrated.com, the progressive, and other media. He's the author of a number of books, which we all have in the back, that people should definitely check out. What's My Name, Fool?, The Muhammad Ali Handbook, Welcome to the Terror Dome. His columns and articles can also be found at the Edge of Sports, www.edgeofsports.com. I know we have a lot of fans here. And Dave now has a radio show, too, on XM, so you can get more Zirin than you ever could have hoped for. And it's also one of the only, it is the only radio show on XM that's both on Sports XM and on Air America XM, which really just, really speaks to the kind of crossover appeal and the depth that Dave has brought to these kind of issues, bringing politics into sports and bringing sports into politics. So without further ado, I want to introduce Dave Zirin.
Thank you, Lucy. I didn't know this was a roast. But I would like to start perhaps with just a quick terrorist fist jab, if I could. Thank you very much. True story. Absolute true story. I was on a sports radio show recently to talk about this book I have coming out called The People's History of Sports in the United States. And very excited. Or maybe just me. But I'm on this show, and the host starts by saying, "All right, we're here with Dave Zirin." And immediately I'm thinking, oh, Christ, because two things. One, he didn't pronounce my name right. And two, he had that deep sports radio voice, as if his testicles were just so big. And he was so full of macho that it was an effort for him to even talk. You know, that what I call the jackass sports radio voice. And he looks at, he doesn't look at me because it was over the phone, but he says to me, so I read the book, and first of all, I had a question because the book wasn't out yet, so I knew also I was in trouble. But he said, "What do you have against sports?" And I said, "Well, nothing. I love sports. I hate the way they're used, but I love sports." And that kind of flummoxed him for a second. And then he says, "Okay, well, what do you have against America?" And I said, "Well, where do you want to start? I don't know." And then he got really upset and he started screaming and he said, I knew it. You're with that Blame America crowd." And I said, "Yes, I am. Why are we shouting?" And it kind of went downhill from there. And we never actually talked about what we mean by a people's history of sports. So let's do that right now. The starting point is that most sports history writing is just absolutely painful to read. It's like gargling with gasoline. I mean, here is how it usually goes down if you've ever read any of these books. You have a hero with obstacles in his or her path. Usually his, you have to say. But all obstacles are overcome with greatness affirmed by winning the big game and, for the true immortals, getting on a box of Wheaties. Here's an example. It's from the autobiography of Cal Ripken Jr. called The Only Way I Know. Now, if you don't know who Cal Ripken Jr. is, he was a baseball player who became a legend and a media darling by playing in 2,632 consecutive games. He was, as a comrade of ours, Ashley Smith, once put so gracefully, the boss's wet dream, the worker who never gets sick. Now, here's how Ripken's memoir begins. This is the opening lines. It says, "When I was called to the big leagues with the Baltimore Orioles in 1981, I sat on the bench for the first time in my life, and I have to say, this wasn't what I had in mind. My father was an Orioles third base coach, but my last name wasn't going to help me win a starting position. It doesn't work that way in the majors. I'm John McCain, and I approve this message." Now, this is one problem with sports history, and I think you can hear it. It is usually hyper-individualistic, completely absent of any kind of context whatsoever. And in other words, it's a lot like history, like a lot of the history we're forced to read in general, like in school and whatnot. And the other problem with sports history is that much of it is based on lies. Once again, like history. I mean, you could sort of call it like lies my gym teacher told me. Let me give you a quick example here. Let's take baseball. Baseball, that beautiful All-American game. The Baseball Hall of Fame is in All-American Cooperstown, New York, as you probably might know. Why is that? It's because that's where they tell us the game was invented by the great Army General Abner Doubleday. Now, there are a couple problems with this, however, three in fact. The first is that the game wasn't actually invented in Cooperstown. The second is that Abner Doubleday never set foot in Cooperstown. And the third is that the tiny little fact that Abner Doubleday didn't actually invent baseball. The fact is that the good general didn't know a baseball from a bong. He did not know what a baseball was. Now, this Doubleday myth was created in 1895 by millionaire baseball owner Albert Spalding, as in Spalding Sporting Goods. Spalding chose Cooperstown as the game's birthplace because of its small town beauty, which I guess seemed like a better place than the actual birthplace of baseball, which was Hoboken, New Jersey. Poor Hoboken. It's like no respect. It's unbelievable. And I like Jersey myself, but they were like, it was invented in Jersey? Make it New York, you know, which is a shame. And in choosing General Doubleday as the inventor of the game, this played to Spalding's political goal, which was to merge baseball with the all-American virtues of patriotism and war. Now, is that an exaggeration, maybe a left-wing rant? Let's let Albert Spalding speak for himself on this. After announcing his grand discovery that General Doubleday was the great creator of baseball, he said, "Baseball, I repeat, is war." Subtle. "And the playing of the game is a battle in which every contestant is a commanding general who, having gained an advantage, must hold it by every resource of his mind and muscle." Now, because of people like Albert Spalding and others, we don't have a people's history of sports. We have instead a boss's history of sports, which is based on patriotic blather and lies. But the real history, the real story of how this beauty of play, of sport, developed into the trillion-dollar business we see today can only be understood by looking at the profound economic changes that took place as this country went from a farming society to the military and economic colossus that it is today. So how to understand sports history? Think of it as in three neat parts. There was before the Civil War, when sports was really seen as a sin in this country, as the devil's work, as some sort of blasphemy against God and church. If you were playing sports, you were doing Satan's work. Then there was after the Civil War, as the country developed and sports became something both to sell to people as entertainment, as well as to socialize working class immigrants to see America as the greatest country on earth. And lastly, there's the 20th century, when sports exploded in growth, but also became a platform for spectacular dissent. So let's start with the old times, before the Mayflower, before the slave trade, when John McCain was but a boy. Sorry. I couldn't resist. Unnecessary, whatever. But so here on this land where we're Native Americans, of course, playing a remarkable variety of sports, racing, lacrosse, and even early forms of rugby or football, with games being wild affairs. I mean, the descriptions are really amazing by the early conquistadors and settlers in this country. I mean, games would take days to finish, involving dance, food, and full interaction between men and women, young and old. I mean, to think about Native Americans in sport, for me, is to consider the words of Frederick Engels when he did his famous eulogy at the death of Karl Marx. And this is what Engels said, a section of that eulogy, which is really a remarkable piece of writing. Engels said, "Just as Darwin discovered the law of development of organic nature, so Marx discovered the law of development of human history, the simple fact that mankind must first of all eat, drink, have shelter and clothing before it can pursue politics, science, art, religion, etc." Think of sports as etc. And as soon as Native Americans could clothe and feed themselves, they played. But when the Puritans on the Mayflower and other assorted ships came upon these games in the New World, they were not amused. They were not happy. They flipped out. I mean, they went Bill O'Reilly. You know, if people saw the old clip, you know, that's what the Puritans were like. You know, "We'll do it live!" or whatever. That's basically the reaction of the Puritans when they saw Bill O'Reilly just broke the mic. That's when they saw the game. Should I wait for it to calm down? Okay. Now remember of Britain, and King James was a big believer in promoting sports. And to the Puritans, these games were a symbol of not only King James's decadence, which they despised, but they were also a sinful waste of time, which I guess they thought could be better spent in church or maybe perfecting the wooden shoe. Now, as settlers began to conquer the New World, they outlawed all sports they saw Native Americans play, and even banned such wicked games as lawn bowling and shuffleboard. Yes, even shuffleboard was sin, which is wow. I know, good thing they never saw Sudoku. That would have been... No! So, was sports sin? I mean, it's not just... Like, why was sports sin should really be then the question. Why did they see these innocuous games like shuffleboard as sin? It's not just because they were uptight, although Puritans were certainly that. The main reason was that sports was something untamed and uncontrolled, and by definition then, a distraction from what was the driving motor of society, which was conquering Native Americans, conquering the West, and taming the whole of the United States. And this was the dominant view well into the 19th century. As an early edition of the Congregationalist magazine preached, "Let all our readers, one and all, remember that we were sent into the world not for sport, but for labor, not to enjoy and please ourselves, but to serve and glorify God and be useful. That is the great object and end of life, work." That's like the gospel according to Bill Gates. Thank you very much. And it was during this era, though, before the Civil War, that we see the first mass urbanization in the North, the first waves of poor immigrants living in a stew of just filth and disease. And in this hell on earth, sports started to flourish as a means of basic escape. And the sports people played were done in the shadows and reflected every brutality of this system. I mean, one example was something called bull baiting, where they would turn 10 dogs on a bull and see who, in fact, would then survive. Another big sport was rat baiting, which was actually formed in New York City, which is appropriate somehow, where 100 rats would be dropped into a pit with a starving dog, and people would bet to see how many the dog could kill in a given period of time. And most famously, as people may have seen movies like Gangs of New York, was bare-knuckled boxing, which was only slightly less brutal than bull or rat baiting. In 1842, journalist Horace Greeley recounted with horror a 3-hour boxing match that ended with the death of one of the fighters. And as Greeley wrote, "Let none say his death was accidental. As the patrons cheered, he was immolated on the altar of sport." Yet here we also see the hypocrisy in all of the reformers tut-tutting about this violence, because Greeley, if people are familiar with his name, you probably learned about him in high school as the guy who said, "Go West, young man," as the rallying cry for Native American extermination. And this was typical of a lot of the reformers who tried to moralize or legislate sports out of existence. I mean, they wrote countless articles condemning the evils of bull baiting and bare-knuckled boxing, but actively stood with a system that promoted conquest and genocide. But the bigger point is that in this brutal period before the Civil War, sports just couldn't be legislated or moralized out of existence. What could be legislated, however, and this I found very interesting in researching this, in the South were efforts to make sure that sports didn't become a point of connection between black slaves and the white poor. I mean, Southern states adopted the so-called black codes to legally forbid blacks and whites to interact, particularly in the area of sport. That was a particular area of concern. In 1830, just to give you the text of this, North Carolina passed a law, and this was what they said in this law. They said that it shall not be lawful for any white person to play any game of cards, dice, nine pins, and any game of chance or hazard with any slave or slaves. So this is very broadly sports until the Civil War. Very regional, very outlaw, and very brutal. Now, the Civil War itself did two big things for sport. One, it brought people together in massive armies where they learned about each other's games. That's how baseball actually spread to become the national sport, people playing it in between battles during the Civil War. But it's also where the Civil War, what it did, of course, was it smashed the slave South, creating a unified capitalist colossus. And that's what really laid the groundwork for the explosion of professional sports as we know them today. Because after the Civil War, we see a crazy period of industrial development and immigration. And the numbers are really staggering. I don't know if people know the actual data here. Like from 1860 to 1900, the population of the US grew from 31 million to 75 million in 40 years. New York went from 800,000 to 4 million. Chicago from 100,000 to 2 million in 40 years. Railroads were built that connected each end of the country. This was the era of booms for the new rich, who were known as the robber barons, and busts for everybody else. Now in 1877, these tensions absolutely exploded, which became the year as known as the Great General Strike. There was a strike wave that was put down with absolutely bloody force, and that really laid the groundwork for the fights for the 8-hour day, more strikes, more oppression. I mean, the country was really, it seemed like, was coming apart piece by piece. Super rich, people dying in filth and disease. The New York Times once wrote an article where they just stated, matter-of-factly, about 1,000 infants dying every week in New York because of sewage getting into the drinking water. This was the reality in 1877. And for the bosses, it became very clear, very open, very clear, very articulated, that more was needed than just rifles and bayonets. They needed to figure out ways to ensure order and properly socialize their workers. And here we see the birth of the idea that sports could be used to promote so-called American values among the poor. And the robber barons put millions of dollars to making sure that sports were an option for young immigrants. I mean, this is how you see the start of things like, you know, your local YMCA. I mean, the Y, by 1880, there were 261 Y gyms across the country. And as one historian I like wrote about the formation of the Y, he wrote, "The Y's gospel was that play was no longer a sin, but a way to glory God, and Jesus was now a sinewy stud," which is just creepy. They then took it a step further as people like Rockefeller, Carnegie, Vanderbilt, they underwrote the first ever public school athletic league in New York City. I mean, sports were now in urban schools, and this was not by public funding, this was privately funded as a way to socialize immigrants, particularly immigrant boys. But this sports explosion wasn't about controlling workers, and this is very important. It was also about making young members of the new ruling elite fit to rule. That was a big part of sports, because there's this fear, and it's fascinating to read, this fear gripped these new robber barons that their own pampered, privileged children were completely unprepared to navigate this violent world that they themselves had created. And their concern bordered on the hysterical. This is what Oliver Wendell Holmes, the father of the more famous Oliver Wendell Holmes, who became a Supreme Court judge, this is what he wrote in the Atlantic Monthly towards the end of the 19th century. And it's a lot more fun to hear this quote and think about it being said by Montgomery Burns from The Simpsons. But I won't do an impression. Okay, sure, I will. But this is what Oliver Wendell Holmes said. He said, "I am satisfied, Smithers," no, he didn't say Smithers, but he said, I am satisfied that such a set of black-coated, stiff-jointed, soft-muscled, paste-complexioned youth as we can boast in our Atlantic cities never before sprang from the loins of Anglo-Saxon lineage." Now, I don't know about you, but I don't really regret that the phrase "sprang from the loins" has left the language. I'm just kind of glad. But sports was seen as an answer for these, as they put it, the spindle-shanked, paste-complexioned, soft-muscled young elites. This was a way that maybe they could be toughened up to navigate this brutal world that was existing. And so you had, it was crazy. You had elite schools like Harvard, Yale, and Brown began initiating intercollegiate football games, which resembled something out of Braveheart. Dozens of deaths every year on football fields, because they would just be running into each other until they died. I mean, take a step back and think about what a sick society this is. You have economic elites sending their children to die in Ivy League football games merely because they were terrified they wouldn't be tough enough to lead the genocide abroad and industrial murder at home. And this culture of death was proudly known as muscular Christianity. And its most prominent spokesperson, the prom king of this culture of death, was an aristocratic asthmatic named Theodore Roosevelt.
Now, Theodore Roosevelt would rail repeatedly against a new word that had been created to describe this new generation of pasty-complexioned, spindle-shanked young elites. And, this is where the origins of this word is, the sissy. That's where the sissy comes out of this. And all of you look at Roosevelt's writing, he would constantly talk about the sissies, and we need to get rid of the sissies. And he saw tough athletic training, and it's interesting if you think about homophobia in men's sports, how the roots of the word sissy in this. He saw tough athletic training as a way to build this new, as he put it, Anglo-Saxon super race, which I guess would spring from their loins while carrying a big stick. I don't know. And I know this can all seem kind of like macho idiocy, you know, testosterone run amok, and some of it is, but this is not machismo for machismo's sake. These ideas of muscular Christianity were about preparing the United States for empire. This is the period, keep in mind, where the U.S. is invading the Philippines, Latin America, the Caribbean, and these values of sports were deeply tied to ideas about spreading Christianity by force and conquering other lands. In fact, Albert Spalding, you might remember him, he spoke very proudly about baseball as a kind of helping hand for U.S. imperialism, the guy who made up the Doubleday myth about baseball. And this is what's when they started invading other countries, like it was like Spalding ran to the nearest whatever, I guess, mounted for a microphone then. I guess they didn't have electricity, or maybe they did. I don't know that part of history too well. But Spalding ran to reporters and he said, you know, baseball, and Spalding is just a repellent creature, by the way. You read about him like an anti-union bigot, all that stuff. But he runs and he goes, you know, baseball has proudly followed the flag. It has followed the flag to the Hawaiian Islands, it has followed the flag to the Philippines, to Puerto Rico, and to Cuba, and wherever a ship floating the Stars and Stripes finds anchorage today, somewhere on a nearby shore, the American national game is in progress. So you see how sports is used to calm radicalism at home and prepare people for war abroad. And for working class adults, we also see the growth now of spectator sports. Major League Baseball, horse racing, boxing with gloves, these became like the good sports and began to blow up as big business. And this was a tool both of escape and a way to further transmit the values of sport to young, to more adult, people who are out of the public school level, young immigrants, working class people in the cities. But what's so interesting is that as these sports professionalize, one of the first things that you see is that they also become whitened, with black competitors expelled from what had been integrated games. I mean, and this was, of course, very closely tied to the defeat of Reconstruction, the birth of Jim Crow in the South, but it's so striking to me how quickly sports snapped to attention and how they became a public symbol of division and white supremacy. I mean, in baseball, you have a color line, as African-American players like Moses Fleetwood Walker were physically removed from the field of play while still in uniform. In horse racing, a color line. Horse racing was a sport dominated by African-American jockeys. You know, the first Kentucky Derby in 1875, of the 15 jockeys, 14 were African-American. By 1895, it's an all-white sport. Even in cockfighting, you could have a match where two chickens tore each other's heads off, but heaven forbid, one chicken belonged to a white guy and one to a black guy. Now, amidst all this segregation, cockfighting and loin springing, it's probably worth asking, where are women in all this? You think? Now, for women, particularly middle and upper class women, sports was something that they were simply denied. Denied the benefits of exercise, physical fitness, healthy living. I mean, it was whalebone corsets and the vapors. And a whole cottage industry of quack science developed to explain how sports could cause women to become infertile, sports would cause women to become prostitutes, to become lesbians, to do everything short of growing a tail. That's what was laid out by the quack science. And I do want to take the time to read, just so you know I'm not over the top here. This was a writer who wrote this in an 1878 edition of the American Christian Review. And he was diagramming the 12-step downfall of any woman who dared engage in the sinful world of croquet. And I just want to tell you, and please, I really want to tell you guys, it is a slippery, for the ladies out there, it is a slippery slope. These are the 12 steps if you get involved with croquet. 1, a social party. 2, a social and play party. 3, a croquet party. 4, a picnic and croquet party. 5, picnic, croquet, and dance. 6, absence of church. You see where this is going. 7, immoral conduct. 8, exclusion from the church. 9, this is my favorite, more croquet. 10, poverty. 11, shame and disgrace, and 12, ruin. And you thought it was just croquet. Now, for working class women without access to croquet who may have led more physically active lives, the social pressure to not play was no less stifling. And therefore, for women activists, for the early suffragettes, sports, the mere access to the physical, came to symbolize their very liberation. I mean, the bicycle in particular was a potent symbol. In 1895, 19 years before women won the right to vote, suffragette Elizabeth Cady Stanton wrote, "Many a woman is riding to the suffrage on a bike." Indeed, Stanton recognized that the right to physical play was deeply tied to liberation. And she wrote this amazing article in a woman's magazine called The Lily, where she wholeheartedly rejected claims of men's physical superiority. It's a terrific piece. And one of the things she writes is, "We cannot say what the woman might be physically if the girl were allowed all the freedom of the boy in running, swimming, climbing, or playing ball." Now, Stanton, as you might imagine, was vilified for such an assertion, but to me it's a great jumping off point to where I'm going to end the talk here, which is the whole of the 20th century, where sports become a place where the worst idea of society were not only pushed, but could also be challenged. And this, in so many ways, is the hidden story of sports in the 20th century. And the best advice I can give is please, please, please come at 4 o'clock today to hear Dave Megacy and the great John Carlos, and you can learn for yourself how sports became a site of struggle in the 20th century. But I do want to give three examples. Jack Johnson, Jackie Robinson, and Billie Jean King. They create an interesting three-part way of understanding the 20th century. I mean, so let's start with Jack Johnson. Now, to be clear, this is the boxer Jack Johnson, not the folk singer. And although the fact that they share a name is just yet another indignity that Jack Johnson in death must deal with. We got some Jack Johnson fans here. They're like, okay, all right. Now, it's like the great boxer, Jason Mraz. No, boxing, first of all, to be clear, unlike other sports like baseball and horse racing, was actually integrated. But not because the people who ran boxing were like Quakers or anything like that. It was integrated because they wanted to actually benefit from racism, to make a buck off trying to organize so white fighters could beat up black fighters for sport. There was only one problem with this, however, and that's that black fighters kept winning fights. And this really reached its apex in 1908 when Jack Johnson became the first African-American heavyweight champion. And his victory created a serious crisis in the ideas of white supremacy. And the media whipped up this frenzy to say they needed a, quote, a great white hope to restore order to the world. And then former champion Jim Jeffries came out of retirement and said, "I am going into this fight for the sole purpose of proving that a white man is better than a Negro." Now, Jack Johnson's very calm reply to the Dallas Morning News was, "Well, I honestly believe that in pugilism, I am Jeffrey's master. And it is my purpose to demonstrate this in the most decisive way possible. The tap of the gong will be music to me." Now, I can understand that might sound like something that Dame Judi Dench might say to Meryl Streep before the Oscars or something, but you gotta understand that that was verbal TNT at the time. This is 50 years after the end of slavery, and the headline of the Dallas Morning News was, "Johnson claims he will be Jeffrey's master." Now, at the fight itself, which took place in 1910, it literally had a lynch mob atmosphere. The ringside band played a song called "All Coons Look Alike to Me," and promoters led the all-white crowd in racist chants. But Johnson was faster, stronger, and smarter than Jeffries, and he knocked him clear out of the ring. And after Johnson's victory, this is insane, there were race riots around the country, and most of the riots consisted of white lynch mobs attacking blacks and blacks fighting back. And this reaction to a boxing match, was one of the most widespread racial uprisings in the U.S. until the 1968 assassination of civil rights leader Dr. Martin Luther King. And so immediately you had white right-wing religious groups immediately organizing to ban boxing, and Congress actually passed a law in the aftermath of that fight to ban boxing films. And now even some black leaders like Booker T. Washington pushed Johnson to condemn African Americans for rioting and toe the line, and Johnson told Booker T. Washington, and Booker T. Washington was not amused by this, that he could kiss his ass. And Johnson was demonized for this. But Johnson, to the mass of African Americans, was no devil. He was actually becoming folklore. There was actually a Negro spiritual in the South that people sang while working, whether it was on chain gangs or in the sharecropping fields. And this is how the spiritual went. It went, "Amazing grace, how sweet it sounds. Jack Johnson knocked Jim Jeffries down. Jim Jeffries jumped up and hit Jack on the chin, and Jack then knocked him down again. The Yankees may hold the play and the white man pulls the trigger, but it make no difference what the white man say. The world champion's still a N-word. I mean, you get where they're going. Now, Johnson faced harassment and persecution for the rest of his life, and he was eventually arrested and even had to go into exile for taking a white woman across state lines for immoral purposes who happened to be his wife. But this white supremacy in sports, and it did not continue unchallenged. I mean, you had the communist press and the black press as well held rallies and raised the issue of Jim Crow in sports. You had Joe Louis and great Negro League players like Satchel Paige through play, if not through their words, challenge perceptions. But the decisive move toward desegregation in sports doesn't come until after World War II, as the question persisted about why black people could fight for freedom in a U.S. uniform but couldn't play baseball. And the guy who smashed the color line was a vet named Jackie Robinson. How am I doing on time?
Got 12 minutes.
Excellent. Okay. In 1946, Jackie Robinson caught the eye of Brooklyn Dodgers boss Branch Rickey, not just for his skills, but because he was a type. I mean, he was, on the one hand, came from a very solid working class background in Pasadena, California. He graduated from UCLA on a sports scholarship, and he was a military veteran. But he was also someone who, in the military, was brought up for court-martial for refusing to give up his seat on a bus. And this was someone who Branch Rickey thought could be the person to break the color line. And in their first meeting they had together, Rickey asked Jackie Robinson, he said, "I know you have the skills, but do you have the guts?" Which meant, in effect, do you have the guts to take the abuse of bigots and not respond? And it's a fascinating thing because it means that in the decade before the rise of Martin Luther King, Rickey was asking Robinson, a person of tremendous pride, to effectively turn the other cheek. And Robinson was spiked, he had balls thrown at his head, he and his family had death threats, but his struggle began to rub off on his white teammates, challenging their own racism in a way that was very public and a very real education for people around the United States. My favorite story is when they did a barnstorming game in the South, and Jackie Robinson was number 42, and the Klan issued a directive that they would shoot Jackie Robinson on sight when he got off the train. And the captain of the team, Pee Wee Reese, said, "Well, tell them that we're all going to get off the train, and we're all going to be wearing number 42, and then they won't know who to shoot." Which, of course, is funny, because, you know, Robinson's the only black player, and they would. But if they're all wearing 42, they won't know who to shoot. And then when Pee Wee Reese got off the train, he picked up a lot of, I don't know how else to put this, but dried up dog and horse shit, which was sort of on by the tracks. And he would be like, "Hey, I'm looking for the Klan. Where's the Klan here? Is the Klan," you know, picking up shit. So maybe he had to be there. I don't know. But one example where things really started to turn was when 1947, they're playing against the Philadelphia Phillies. And during the game, the other team is just, they're chanting the N-word at him from the other dugout every time he takes any step anywhere. And this is what Jackie Robinson remembered in his autobiography. He wrote, "I felt tortured and I tried to just play ball and ignore the insults. But for one wild and rage-crazed moment, I thought, to hell with Mr. Rickey's noble experiment. To hell with the image of the patient black freak I was supposed to create. I could throw down my bat, stride over to that Phillies dugout, grab one of those white sons of bitches and smash his teeth in with my despised black fist." So his is a little different from Cal Ripken's autobiography. But what happened, though, was his teammates actually then started to pick up bats and go over to the Phillies dugout to shut them up. And that's what began to really bring the team together. And Robinson flourished. He won the first ever Rookie of the Year award, and he became a media darling as sort of the black athlete who was doing it the right way. But that praise really came with a price, particularly in the late 40s at the height of the reactionary anti-communist Red Scare known as McCarthyism. I mean, this was the price that Jackie Robinson played for succeeding in this period of such utter reaction. I mean, the first was that he voluntarily testified in 1949 against the great African-American political figure Paul Robeson for the House Committee of Un-American Activities, something he later called his greatest regret, but something he was called upon to do. And the second price he paid was as a new generation of African-American athletes came alive in the 60s, Robinson was seen as conservative and behind the times. And Malcolm X once said acidly that Jackie Robinson is the white man's hero. But Robinson was far more than that. I mean, after he retired in 1956, he became a barnstorming speaker for civil rights, and he would do speeches throughout the South, and he would say things like, "If I had to choose between the Baseball Hall of Fame and full citizenship for my people, I would choose full citizenship time and again." And Even if in the 1960s he was seen as a man of the past, it's worth saying that in 1968 he was somebody who publicly supported people like John Carlos and Tommy Smith and the African-American revolt at the 68 Olympics, when other older African-American stars like Joe Louis and Jesse Owens did not. And Robinson, I think we can say, laid the groundwork for people like Muhammad Ali, Curt Flood, and the entire era of the Black Athletes' Revolt, which also sparked the women's athletic revolt, emblemized by the great Billie Jean King. So let's talk about the legend of Billie Jean, who both shaped and was a shaper of the movement for women's liberation. I mean, as early as 1968, at age 24, she was protesting for equal pay, better training facilities, and respect for women's players. And about this time, King also lent her name to a full-page ad. The heading read simply, "I had an abortion." This is years before Roe versus Wade. You can imagine any public woman figure doing something like that today. It says something about where King was back then, and then also where we are today. But her impact was demonstrated in utterly dramatic fashion in 1973, when King faced off against Bobby Riggs in their Battle of the Sexes tennis match, which was called by the London Times the drop shot and volley heard round the world. And that's tennis humor. King was a retired Wimbledon champion, and he was a proud, as he put it, male chauvinist pig. And, you know, that could sound almost quaint now, like, the 70s, you know, whatever. But for Riggs and this country, the match was far more than that. This is what Riggs said to the press. I mean, this is just open. He said, "Hell, we know there's no way she can beat me. When the pressure mounts and she thinks about 50 million people watching on TV, she'll fold. That's the way women are. I want to set women's lib back 20 years to get women back into the home where they belong." And King read every quote, and she felt the stakes later, saying, she said, "I thought it would set us back 50 years if I lost." And the Battle of the Sexes match, it captured the imagination of the country, and it's still one of the most watched events in history. And I think it's one of those terrific events, if you ever see it, where the hype actually exceeded the results. And that's a good thing, because there was no hype, because King was so superior to Riggs, and she beat him 6-4, 6-3, 6-3. And just brilliant decimation of Bobby Riggs. But politically, it's worth applauding. I mean, this is one of the most watched events in TV history, you know, sold out Houston Astrodome. But politically, King did so much more than beat Riggs. I mean, she fought for a women's players union. She marched in the streets for women's rights wherever they were threatened. And she was also the first prominent athlete to come out of the closet as an open lesbian, even though she was outed against her will. She just took that up, even though it was not in circumstances she would choose. But the Riggs match was really her defining moment, proving that the representative power of sports can at times dwarf the actions themselves. And King's victory can't be separated from something that she fought in the streets for, along with thousands of others, and that's Title IX, which guaranteed equal funding for men's and women's educational opportunities, but is most closely tied to issues of sports. I mean, the numbers really are staggering here. I mean, according to the Women's Sports Foundation, one in three women in junior high or high school play sports. And before Title IX, it was 1 in 27. And women who play sports, according to their studies, are far less likely to be involved in abusive relationships or have eating disorders. In other words, it's a reform that's improved the quality of life of tens of millions of women in this country. And it's one of the great enduring victories of that period of struggle. And that's really the point of highlighting people like Jack Johnson, Jackie Robinson, and Billie Jean King, is that it shows how words and actions and even play of pro athletes can affect the world far beyond the sports page. And I'll just end by saying that this history lives on today, and it's alive anytime athletes today, like Eitan Thomas or Steve Nash, use their platform to speak out against injustice. But it's also alive when we see sports not as some kind of right-wing refuge, but as something worth fighting for, when we're part of campaigns to make sure our tax dollars aren't used to build stadiums while physical education is on the chopping block. And it's also alive when we look at things like the epidemic in this country of childhood obesity and understand that this is not a product of affluence, but a product of poverty, of crap food, of an absence of public space and equipment for kids to actually play. And it's alive when we look at a city like Minneapolis, the site of the Republican National Convention, and speak about the utter obscenity that a $500 million stadium is being built there while bridges collapse. And that's the point of being armed with a people's history of sports, is that it shows that while this idea that we're sold at a young age of a level playing field is an absolute lie, the playing field itself is something we should fight with all of our hearts to reclaim. Because it's a very simple idea. I mean, this playing field that we talk about, it was ours long before it was ever theirs. Thank you very much.
Great. Thanks so much, Dave. So if people are wondering, the people...
Yeah, this is just, I want to be real quick because there's some great questions here too, and this is just to clear stuff out of the way so the wrap-up isn't like, and point 42, subset 3. So just very, very quickly, first, I really wanted to come back on the issue about like gay athletes, Billie Jean King. I mean, there is a very powerful and important tradition of women athletes who've come out of the closet that's profound. I mean, the first time I ever knew there was such a thing as gay people was I remember being like 8 years old and hearing about Martina Navratilova, and then she brought her partner to Wimbledon to sit in the section with the spouses. I mean, this was an education for people. But it's not just Martina. I mean, this past year, perhaps the most prominent African-American woman came out of the closet in the history of the United States, and Cheryl Swoopes of the WNBA, the most, arguably the best women's basketball player to ever live. Other women tennis players like Amélie Mauresmo as well. Now, in men's sports, it's certainly much more fraught with peril. I mean, homophobia in both women's and men's sports, it runs deep in the marrow of both of those sports. But in men's sports, particularly so, for precisely some of the reasons we talked about, is that the idea, which we can thank Teddy Roosevelt and his ilk for, this idea that being gay somehow connotes being weak. And that's why I took time in the book, People's History of Sports, which isn't here, but check it out, to have a whole section about the history of the gay games, which started in the 1980s, because it was really a fascinating way to try to take all those ideas and turn them on their head and to show that competition could actually be about celebrating each other and not about trying to destroy each other, while at the same time showing that both gay men and women, LGBT, and they had every category of play, could be something that could be celebrated and something real and something that people believed in. And that sport, it's the genius of the gay games was that it showed that sports do not have to be inherently homophobic, that homophobia is something that's been sort of stuck onto sports and sports has been used to push homophobia, but it that's certainly not the way it has to be. And then the second thing is just very briefly is just about Kenneth Foster. I mean, this actually a year ago at this conference, Marlene Martin of the Campaign to End the Death Penalty was like, there's this guy you probably not even heard of named Kenneth Foster in Texas. And I said, yeah, I've never heard of him. Who does he play for? And she said, no, he's actually on death row. And it's beyond foul, and he might die very soon. And is there anything that we can do to build a campaign? And so it seemed easy enough, you know, wrote up a statement, got people, like athletes past and present to sign on to it, published it in a few places, sent Kenneth Foster a copy of the books, we corresponded. But then the fit kind of hit the shan, so to speak, when they banned What's My Name Fool from being sent to him, calling it like seditious material or something. And then that became the basis of sort of like, what is it about sports that they're so afraid of someone that they want to kill anyway? You know, what is it that they fear? And then that's what got published and got a lot of press in the Houston Chronicle and the Fort Worth Telegram Star. But the main thing that it did is it's less about the book and even less about Kenneth and more about that it raised the profile of the case. And that was the thing about Kenneth's case is that you looked at it and you're like, why are they gonna kill this guy? What's going, you know? And that's the important thing about sometimes how sports can be used. I mean, it's a tragedy, but a fact that far more people read the sports page than the front page. But if you can use the sports page as a place to talk about some of these ideas, I really do think it's a way to get people to sort of peel their eyes back and be like, whoa, something stinks in this country and we have to do something about it. There will be no enlightening, but I will say, just a point of pride, I want people to know that, I don't know if he's still here, but I have a 2-month-old son now, and he's now ranked number 6 in terms of basketball players on the East Coast. We're pushing him. We're going to be up to 5 by next year, you know what? It's back to the basement, he goes. No. Why would that be funny? All right, seriously. In all seriousness, first of all, I hope people... don't see this as a, as we say sometimes, a dick move, but when you're talking about the Beijing Olympics or you're talking about the Chicago Olympics or when you're talking about sports and labor, I mean, we're gonna be talking about that today at 4:00, then people should come because we're gonna be, that would be the dick move and me not answering it, but saying, please come at 4:00, where it would be, myself, but also Dave Megacy, who's not only played in the NFL and walked away from the NFL in 1969 to protest the Vietnam War and wrote one of the best sports autobiographies in human history called Out of Their League. But he also is somebody who is the West Coast head of the NFL Players Association. And also Mr. John Carlos, who has had more than a few things to say about the idea of the Olympics coming to Chicago, raising the question, which I think is a very courageous question to raise, which is, if the Chicago police are this bad in normal times, what would they be like having that under the curtain of the Olympics and that sort of get out of jail free card that cops seem to get, whether you're talking about Beijing, Greece, Atlanta, Sydney? That's when the brutality really comes. And when you think about Chicago's track record, that is a scary, scary thought. And John Carlos has had the courage to raise that to his credit. And I'd be so remiss if I didn't say how proud I was that John Carlos is here today in the back, if people want to give him a shout out over there. There, Dr. John. And I should say, for the record, he specifically asked me not to do that. But that's the good thing about having the mic, is you get to do things that people ask you not to do, like embarrass your two-month-old son. Okay, so, the only thing I want to talk about, though, is this idea of the future of sports, because it brings together both Lucy's question about where things are going in terms of, like, these hyper-intense professional sports, and also Nick's question about what would sports look like in a society that wasn't so exploitative. And so, first of all, the immediate future of sports, I would argue, is very dark. This is not pretty, what's happening in this country right now. And this is one of the things that got me involved in sports writing, as I was teaching third grade in DC public schools, and they cut phys ed. No more recess for third graders, and no more gym teachers for third graders. But then, within weeks of them cutting phys ed, you had kids come into the classroom, just a couple of kids, and they were boys, coming in wearing their new traveling soccer jerseys with a sponsor's name on the back at third grade. And so all of a sudden you're seeing it at age 8 years old, the message is being pounded into these kids, is that sport is something only for those who can actually be amazing at it. And if, God forbid, you're too slow, too fat, too thin, or too much of a girl, then sports is immediately something that is not offered to you. And that's something that's absolutely sick. And so when you're talking about the immediate feature of sports, you're talking about sports becoming something that's gonna be as polarized as the rest of society, something that's a have or have not kind of situation. I mean, the parents that can afford it or the parents that can sacrifice, and that's another thing that happens, working class parents who sacrifice because they think, not without good reason, that it's the only chance for their kids to actually get out. Then for them, the sacrifices are made. And that's also why you're seeing this rash of injuries, not just among young girls, which is the New York Times article that Lucy, I know, has read, but also among young boys, too, crippling injuries that they're dealing with precisely because the level of play that they're being expected to do with very high profit stakes among sponsors is so high. And you talk about the famous quote, I was just thinking about it from the Communist Manifesto, where Marx talks about, like, in this society, all that's holy is profaned. What could be more profane than taking a child's desire to play, putting a price tag on that, and then watching them drive their bodies into smithereens before they even hit puberty? That is absolutely profane, and that is the immediate feature of sports that we're looking at. But then you ask about, well, how could sports be done differently? What would it look like in a society that wasn't so incredibly brutal to the people who actually have to live in it? And the first thing I think you would see, it's a very simple thing, but access. Access. This idea that if you want to play, it's there for you to do. The second thing would be people being healthier. I mentioned this in the talk, but I don't think it could be said too much. When people talk about childhood obesity, what drives me nuts is when they talk about it as if it's a symptom of affluence. When it's not a product of affluence, it's a product actually of poverty, and it's a product of what's in our food and the absence of physical exercise. And if people want proof of that, the country that's now number one in childhood obesity per capita is no longer the United States, it's Mexico. And it's Mexico for the simple reason of, one, privatization, lack of access to play, and two, because the country that domesticated corn now has a corn shortage because of the price of food, and so what's being imported is white flour tortillas that are being eaten there, which is causing the weight of young children to absolutely explode. So, well, that first thing is just access, and you would also see health. But the second thing, and I'll end on this point, is that I think you would see access for all of us, not just kids, but all of us. No more being too tired at the end of the day to actually do something and go out and physically exercise. No more like having restrictions from being able to get together with your friends and actually organize something fun together. You know, that it wasn't about, you know, will I make money or will I not? And also no more hyper-exploitation of the best athletes among us. And I think in a socialist society, I really do believe this, you would still have some kind of professional sports, some kind of joy of people coming to watch sports, people who are really good at something, we would want to see them do it at their best. That's a good thing. It's not like, oh, well, Michael Jordan wouldn't play basketball in a socialist, you know, he'd be too, you know, no. People who are good at things would do them. But what you wouldn't see, and I've seen this way too many times at some of these retirement dinners for NFL players, you wouldn't see people looking like they're elderly at age 40. You wouldn't see, as Dave Megacy once said to me, the idea of people signing away their right to have a middle age. You wouldn't see people who at age 32 could run 40 yards in 4.4, but by the time they're 42, they need a cane. You wouldn't see that anymore. And I think that would be something we would celebrate no longer having to see, because it's something horrible about the fact that Johnny Unitas, who may have been the greatest quarterback in history, couldn't pick up a football at the time of his death. There's something just absolutely sick about that that speaks to what our society looks like. And I'll even say that for the Brett Favre fan in the house. You're going to see what Brett Favre looks like in 20 years, and it's going to be something that I think is a horrible window in our society. But the last thing about access is, I'll just say this, I'm going to speak for myself here, and this is what I think is something hopeful and something to think about. I played high school sports. I played basketball and baseball. Honestly, I don't think I could have jumped on a magazine. Very, very bad athletic skills. I was also very slow. I mean, my coach used to say when I would run to first base, he said, I could time you with a sundial. But I'll tell you something, this too. It may not have been pretty, and I'm so grateful there are no videotapes out there or anything of me actually swinging a bat or jumping or not jumping. But I'll tell you, it's like when I close my eyes and think about it, like the memories are awesome. I mean, it's like, you know, the thrill of it was so exciting. You know, the fact that like our sports teams were the only integrated group in the high school. You'd go to the cafeteria and it would look like a 1950s lunch counter, except where the athletes were, and we would hang out and we would be together. And there was something really beautiful about that still gives me chills when I talk about. But you know what? After high school, it just stopped, and that's it. And every sports thrill I've gotten since then has been as a watcher and not as a player. And that's part of the problem. And I think when we talk about a sports in a world without exploitation, people should think back to the coolest sports moments they've ever seen. For me, I'm thinking about Michael Jordan against the Portland Trail Blazers in, I believe, 1992. He hits six three-pointers in the first half, and as he's running back up the court, as Susan is demonstrating, he goes like this. It's like, I can't even believe I'm this good. And how cool that moment was. And imagine if that moment wasn't just the property of Michael Jordan, but was something that we could all actually experience, of being like, wow, I didn't know I could be that good. Thank you very much. That's it.